I think Friday someone's probably wanted just to come in and cool down. Again, we've got a little interactive service. We have me, Tracy, if you're not sure who I am, I'm the licensed evangelist, and we have our other licensed children's families minister, Diana, today. So it's amazing, very lucky to have two licensed ministers to be able to take on some of the lay work. Our interactive service again has Jane with our intercessions and Chris's sermon will all pop up on the screen. I've checked it. It will work. Today's service is again morning prayer.
Grace, mercy and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
This is the day that the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
We have come together in the name of Christ to offer our praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive God's holy word, to pray for the needs of the world, and to seek the forgiveness of our sins, that by the power of our Holy Spirit we may give ourselves to the service of God.
The night has passed, and the day lies open before us. Let us pray with one heart and mind. As we rejoice in the gift of this new day, so may the light of your presence, O God, set our hearts on fire with love for you, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
And now we're going to listen to our first hymn, Fill Your Hearts with Joy.
Christ our Lord.
Amen. May our God God of healing and love, who sent his Son into the world to save sinful humanity, bring us his pardon and peace, now and forever. Amen.
Fortini!
For we have heard the voice of our prayer.
Therefore shall our hearts dance for joy,
and in our song will we praise our God.
Blessed are you, Lord our God, Creator and Redeemer of all. To you be glory and praise forever. From the waters of chaos you drew forth the world, and in your great love fashioned us in your image.
Now, through the deep waters of death, you have brought your people to new birth by raising your Son in life, in triumph. May Christ your light ever dawn in our hearts as we offer you our sacrifice of thanks and praise. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be God forever.
We're now going to listen to our second hymn, I, the Lord of Sea and Sky.
I will give my life to them.
and you that have no money, come, buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labour for that which does not satisfy? Listen carefully to me, and eat what is good, and delight yourselves in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me. Listen so that you may live. I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love for David. See, I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and commander for the peoples. See, you shall call nations that you do not know, and nations that do not know you shall run to you, because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Speaking the truth in Christ. I am not lying. My conscience confirms it by the Holy Spirit. I have great sorrow and unceasing anguish in my heart, for I could wish that I myself were accursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my own people, my kindred, according to the flesh. They are Israelites, and to them belong the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, the worship, and the promises. To them belong the patriarchs, and from them, according to the flesh, comes the Messiah, who is over all, God blessed forever. Amen.
Mercy on us.
You take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
We pray the collect for today. Almighty Lord and everlasting God, we beseech you to direct, sanctify and govern both our hearts and bodies in the ways of your laws and the works of your commandments, that through your most mighty protection, both here and ever, we may be preserved in body and soul, through our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
The gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When Jesus heard that Herod had beheaded John the Baptist, he withdrew in a boat to a deserted place by himself. But when the crowds heard it, they followed him on foot from the towns. When he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion for them and cured their sick. When it was evening, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a deserted place, and the hour is now late. Send the crowds away, so that they may go into the villages and buy food for themselves." Jesus said to them, "They need not go away. You give them something to eat." They replied, "We have nothing here but 5 loaves and 2 fish. And he said, "Bring them here to me." Then he ordered the crowds to sit down on the grass. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven and blessed and broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples. And the disciples gave them to the crowds. And all ate and were filled. And they took up what was left over of the broken pieces, 12 baskets and 4. And those who ate were about 5,000 men, besides women and children. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Technology that we've been discovering during lockdown. So I'm really happy to be able to talk to you this Sunday morning, although I'm not actually physically here. For the past few Sundays, our gospel readings have been focused on Jesus' parables as recorded by Matthew. First, there was the parable of the sower, and then the parable of the weeds and the wheat, and lastly, a whole bonanza of parables. The mustard seed, the pearl, the yeast, the dough, the baker woman. Jesus uses parables to teach his followers about his vision of the kingdom of God. And he begins each parable by saying, "The kingdom of heaven is like," and then he kind of spins a short, simple story filled with fabulous characters and striking events. Jesus was a master of this style. And parables make up approximately a third of his teaching in the New Testament. Teaching in parables is as powerful today as it was in the first century. We still use stories each day to explain the world, picture language to enliven our speech, and so on. But in today's gospel, we turn from parable to miracle, with Matthew's version of the feeding of the 5,000. Miracles, for better or for worse, are much less convincing to the modern mind than parables are. In our contemporary scientific world, we know that people can't walk on water, and water doesn't suddenly turn into wine, and that 5 loaves of bread will never be enough to feed 5,000 people. And sometimes these stories seem childish at best, foolish at worst, mere wish fulfillment, disconnected from reality. At their worst, an attempt to manipulate the gospel. Miracle stories were common in the ancient world, within Christianity and beyond. Telling and retelling the stories of Jesus' miracles was an important way that Jesus' earlier followers remembered and honoured him, and how they tried to share his good news with others. And the story we heard today, the story of Jesus feeding the multitude, was perhaps the most important miracle of all. It's the only miracle included in all of the Gospels. Matthew and Mark like the story so much, in fact, that they each tell it twice. That means the story is told 6 times in the Gospels, and there are only 4 Gospels. Perhaps there's more going on in the story than just an entertaining fairy tale. Each version presents the same dilemma. Crowds have followed Jesus out to a deserted place to hear him teach. When evening comes, it becomes clear that people haven't come prepared. There's not enough food. The disciples only have a few loaves of bread and a couple of fish. And the people are hungry. And the disciples don't know what to do. In some versions, as in Matthew today, they suggest that Jesus should send people away, fend for themselves in the nearby villages. In some versions, again, as in Matthew today, Jesus turns to the disciples and tells them, "You give them something." Now, many biblical scholars tell us that the miracle stories in the Gospels are really parables in disguise. Miracles are parables told about Jesus and should be understood in a similar way to parables and taken just as seriously. The miracle that we heard today may seem simple on the surface. Jesus is magically able to multiply bread and fish, but if you dig down a bit deeper, it's really a parable about how we see the world. Is there enough to go around or not? What does Jesus mean to share this world God has given to us? What kind of people are we going to be after COVID-19? Those who share or those who hoard everything for themselves? You give them something to eat is the heart of this miracle. Jesus is saying those words to us today, just as clearly as he said to them to his disciples on the deserted shores of the Sea of Galilee all those centuries ago. There is a hungry world out there, and it's our responsibility, our duty, to feed them. There's a crisis in Yemen. There's a crisis in southern Sudan, where millions go hungry as coronavirus decimates an already starving and traumatized people. We can't ignore it. It's our Christian duty to look beyond our own crisis and pay heed to the crisis of starving human beings who don't have a National Health Service to fall back on. And of course we resist it, and it looks like there's not enough bread to go around, so we better hold on tight to ours. But the miracle that we recounted today teaches us that if we open our eyes, we'll see that there is enough. That God has really already provided enough bread to feed every single last person on earth, even and especially in a pandemic. There's enough, It just depends on how you divide it up. God's feast is not an exclusive private gala for the rich and the powerful. Jesus' feast is inclusive of everyone in that crowd, a life-saving picnic for the poor and for the oppressed. In the Eucharist that we reenact, Jesus' picnic for the 5,000 on the lakeshore is a reminder of just that. Jesus takes our bread, blesses it. Jesus takes our bread, breaks it. Jesus takes our bread and shares it with all who are hungry, and is calling us to do the same. Take the blessings that God has given, break them open, and share them with other people. Jesus is calling us today to throw a party where no one goes hungry, where there is bread and joy and life for all. It happens because we do as Jesus did, as we seek to be the kingdom of God for the people of God. Feed the hungry and feed them now. That's what the miracle parable means. Amen.
Let us pray to the Lord, who satisfies all our needs. We give thanks for the ministry of all priests and faithful disciples who follow Jesus' example of outward loving service. Grant that the Church may have grace to feed all who hunger for the word of salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Creator God, may all that encourages the people of the world in goodness, honesty, and compassion be blessed and grow. Give comfort to all who wander in life's wilderness places, and may those in authority have hearts of compassion to not turn away those who need their care. Lord, in your mercy,
hear
our prayer. Father God, we thank you for the joy of human love and for all those among whom we live and work. We pray particularly for any who worry us with their health or circumstances or life direction. Bless the helpers in this community who feed the hungry and bring food to those who cannot prepare it for themselves. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving God, we pray for all who suffer mental or emotional anguish and those who despair. We pray for those facing another day of pain, another day of hunger, another day of fear, especially of the ongoing pandemic. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful God, gather into your eternal kingdom those who have come to the end of this earthly life, and give comfort to those who mourn. We remember all whom we love but can no longer see, and also those recently departed in this parish, George Pinker, John Porter, and June Thurling. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. May we, like Jesus, demonstrate the freedom and joy of self-giving love, and may our prayers be heard through his compassion. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Gathering our prayers and praises into one, as our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
I invite you to stand for the peace. We are the body of Christ. In one spirit, we are all baptized into one body. Let us pursue all that makes for peace and builds up our common life. Amen.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us share by waving or smile a sign of peace with each other.
Let us remind ourselves of God's desire for peace for each and every one of us. And now we listen to our third and final hymn, Guide Me Towards Our Great Redeemer.
Thank you.
Tracy and Diana for leading our service this morning. Also for Jim for leading the hymns and also our musicians to accompany him. Thank you all very much. Just to remind you, if you don't already know, I'm sure you do, as from next week, end 8th of August, it will be mandatory to wear a mask in church. That is with the exception of children under 11 and anyone who has breathing difficulties. So next week, please come prepared. On Wednesday, our midweek Eucharist is going to be taken by Reverend Philip Banks from the Cathedral. So please come along and support Philip, who's going to take a proper Eucharist for us. And the other thing is, can I remind you that the induction of our new vicar, rector, Reverend Max Drinkwater, will take place on Monday, September the 14th at 7:30 here in the church. We look forward to Max coming and joining us with his family here at Haverhill. Thank you.
Thank you, Richard. I'll put down my notes, because Richard's done it. If I could remind you to leave out the side door as probably as you can, but don't forget that once you cross the path, it's not church bound. So if you feel that I should go out and have a little chat, that's leaves us to finish with the grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ,
and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with us all forever.